from the furthest reaches of the internet. This is VIA OBSCURA Radio.
Good evening, and welcome to VIA OBSCURA Radio, a voice of the distant right and platform for exploring new and neglected ideas. Here at VIA OBSCURA, we ask questions unasked by the modern academy and listen to voices unsupported by the modern media to find ideas that can bring us forward. Tonight, I'm flying solo again, largely due to the holidays. It's very hard to put together a podcast episode on the fly with other people. I also think it's quite appropriate for what seems to be a quiet news week. At least at the time of this recording. I think most likely everyone listening to this podcast in any sort of proximity to its release is going to be coming back from family gatherings over the Thanksgiving holiday, maybe meeting with friends to share a meal, or just taking a break from the hubbub of the ordinary news cycle. And I have to confess being in a more or less similar frame of mind. I'm trying to look at the big picture without constantly getting caught up in the tit-for-tat of the culture war, or the prospect of reactionary politics. Still, in my own life and what I've heard from people inside the online right-wing community, even during these moments of respite from politics, from the culture war, from the back and forth of ordinary everyday controversies, people are still looking for a language to express how they really feel about the modern world. They want some way to communicate emotions about how it is to live in modernity. They want a way to express their own spiritual state in a way that might be understood by family members who come from very different political and now even cultural persuasions. On the last episode of VIA OBSCURA, I mentioned briefly how something like this might be found in cultural artifacts, in components of poetry, in components of music, and in the film and media that we consume. And indeed, I think in the past, these cultural products have played a very important role in bridging the gap between ourselves and our friends and family. Still, I don't want to put too much on culture. I don't want to put too much on media. We're dealing with a spiritual crisis, in my opinion, and it's not going to be solved by having a better grasp on classical music or pop culture tropes that can communicate how you're feeling about your relationship in society. That's just silly. Instead, in this episode, I wanted to discuss briefly the need for pure spiritual practices, even if one is not religious themselves. Now, this might sound like a contradiction, but perhaps I can try to explain. Now, this week, for whatever reason, and don't ask me why, I've taken to listening a variety of leftist podcasts, podcasts that are really popular. And among them, chief among them, you might say, is Chapo Trap House, a politics and humor podcast that is highly associated with what a lot of people have called the dirtbag left. Essentially, the podcast seeks to eschew ordinary politeness and civility for a kind of truth be told, we're being irreverent, there are no sacred cows approach to advancing a left-wing political agenda. Now, of course, this being what it is, I knew what I was getting into. I knew I wasn't going to get Meet the Press or Charlie Rose or Dave Rubin. And I am very, very aware of how edgelord humor works, especially when it comes to right-wing edgelords. The kind of humor you would expect on a TRS or an internet blood sports thing or the Ralph retort. I don't like it, but I kind of understand how it works. Nothing is really serious and everything is irreverent. They're trying to knock their opponents off their perch. But with Chapo Trap House, things seemed different. As I listened to a few episodes, and I really only could get through about three of them, I realized that the comedians or the pundits of Chapo Trap House, whatever you want to call them, they weren't trying to knock their opponents off a perch or even put them down. But they were trying to categorically exclude them from consideration, to convince their audience that whatever the opposition was, it wasn't worth talking to them, it wasn't worth considering their interests. The opposition, the conservatives, the reactionaries were just so manifestly pieces of shit, so manifestly worthless that there really didn't even need to be any communication or consideration. There just needed to be dismissal and derision. Now, I know I am from the right. I'm inclined to believe that my own side is better, is not as bad as those people over there on the left. But still, I think this is something that has been very distinctive about the left in our particular moment. And while I'm certainly going to make another video, a more complete video, an edited video, about the issue of reconciliation, especially in light of a left-wing political culture that just does not want to have these conversations, or perhaps does not even want to consider their opposition as people of moral worth, I want to make a separate point here. There is a lot to be said for just being there, for just being present, an active part of another person's life. There's a lot to be said about showing and not telling, about demonstrating through one's actions what one's values are. If people see you praying, it's going to matter more than any apologetic argument you make to atheist or agnostic friends or family. If people see that you're interested and involved in your community, in your local community, that's going to matter much more than any abstract argument about localism. And even if you make an abstract argument about localism, it will be more readily believed if you have skin in the game. Now, oftentimes I tend to be a little bit skeptical of flat invocations to virtue inside an intellectual environment. Most people already know that they need to be good. Most people already know that they should work harder, be nicer, and be more attentive to their responsibilities. That's our main task in life. And while it's certainly very, very hard to do these things, it's not hard for me, sitting here on a podcast, to tell you to do those things. And therefore, it's not much intellectual labor to tell an audience just to be better, to try harder, and to improve themselves with no more elaboration on how. Still, for what it's worth, what I'm trying to communicate here is just how we might underestimate the effects of doing these things on a personal level, how these might reverberate to a larger political consequence. If the opposition is indeed claiming that all people who hold views that come from a remotely right-wing persuasion are terrible or horrible sociopathic people, it does not take much on our part to disprove the lie. All it takes is for us to be present. All it takes is for us to be active, to practice what we preach. And that, in a minimalistic sense, is not incredibly difficult, although coming to full completion is something that virtually no man can ever do. As the Advent season has approached, I've been thinking about this, because far from being a sort of pre-celebration to Christmas, Advent is, in a way, penitential. It is a way to cultivate virtue. And while I don't think it's as explicitly a time for fasting as is Lent, it nevertheless is a time for those who are Christian, or even in a Christian tradition, to hone their own personal virtues, their own spiritual practices, and to remember that whatever our failings are, or whatever our neighbor's failings are, our family's failings, we will, at the end of all of this, be united with them in celebration. The saints and sinners will reconcile. And while there is reconciliation, people will notice the truth. In preparation for Advent, I've talked to one Father Nick about spirituality and the Advent season. I was able to talk to him for about half an hour concerning a variety of topics, mostly spiritual in nature, but not simply restricted to Catholicism. And I hope that this might be a good kickoff for the Advent season. So thank you very much for joining us tonight. My guest is Father Nick from the YouTube channel Frank Friar, and we're here today going to be talking about spirituality in the modern age, especially in the light of the upcoming Advent season. Father Nick has been someone I've followed for quite a long time on YouTube. He has a great YouTube channel, and we'll have the link in the description. And he also is a Franciscan friar, and I thought it would be really nice to talk to him, especially given all of the recent political podcasts we've had, to talk to someone about spirituality, about spiritual well-being in the modern age. So thank you for joining us, Father Nick.
Well, thank you for having me here. I just needed to change one little thing in there. I'm a Carmelite friar.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's okay. It happens all the time. People see the brown robes and they go right to Franciscans. And I got nothing against the Franciscans, but I always like to tease that we're a little bit up on the holy mountain than they are, because us Carmelites were founded on Mount Carmel in the Holy Land. So I'm everything I'm saying tonight is going to be coming out of that sort of Catholic Carmelite perspective.
So perhaps we could start there for listeners who probably aren't too familiar with what a friar is, what a priest even is in some cases, or how the different orders work. Perhaps you could explain what a Carmelite friar is relative to other friars, and how you came to your vocation and joined the order.
Friars, monks, nuns, religious sisters, hermits, consecrated virgins, these are different people who have embraced different vocational calls within the life of the church. So we're all within the Catholic Church, and et cetera. Monks and things do exist in like maybe the Anglican Church, et cetera, and of course the Eastern churches. But in reference to myself as a friar and our Carmelite order and et cetera, we exist within the life of the Catholic Church. The church is our sort of foundation that we grew out of, and et cetera. Mendicants came about, and that's what the religious order started as, where we're sort of mendicants, the street beggars. The monks existed before us for many centuries. But then, St. Francis comes along. He sort of goes into the city, itinerant preaching, starts to beg for money to give to the poor, and et cetera. And then out of his sort of movement, other men and women sort of rose up to sort of emulate that and to embrace that, and et cetera. At a time when the church was somewhat in a moment of decadence, and in debauchery, and et cetera. So to sort of bring back this sort of austere, necessary lifestyle, this open heart that's radically consumed by our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, and witness that and trying to mirror that life of Christ to the people in a variety of different ways. So there are many different groups of mendicants, sort of the big four orders within the church, the big four. There are many others, but the big four that people know about are the Augustinians. They follow the rule of St. Augustine, even though they were not originally founded by Augustine, but they were founded in Italy, and they sort of embraced into his identity. There are the Dominicans, the order of preachers. They were known to be amazing preachers and well-educated people, et cetera. There were the Franciscans. They emulated the poor Christ, radical poverty, hold on to nothing, journey with a leper, et cetera. And then as Carmelites, we started sort of outside of that European context, even though there were many Europeans that influenced our foundation. We were founded in the Holy Land a little bit before the Crusades really picked up. Many hermits sort of settling on Mount Carmel. We were sort of there. We wanted to be hermits. We would take care of pilgrims as they were coming, and et cetera. And we went to Mount Carmel because there was the well of Elijah was there. So we tied ourselves into that spirituality of the place, the Elijah sort of tradition within the Old Testament, one of the great and preeminent prophets in the first and second book of Kings. He was the one that kept the rains from falling, that brought the widow Zarephath's son back from death, and a variety of other things. But then, of course, when the Crusades went bad, us Carmelites were pushed back into Europe. The brothers started to go to a variety of different countries that were their homeland. And then we were brought up into the mendicant movement. So within the Carmelite life, within the Carmelite spirituality, there's sort of this tension of being that hermit, sort of living, in the cave and just learning how to wrestle with the Lord in that place of intimacy, but then also being that mendicant to go out into the world, to care for the poor, to do the work of the Lord to all those people that the Father has entrusted with us on our travels, and et cetera. So I'll just say one more thing maybe about sort of mendicant spirituality as a big picture, because that's what I'm going to be able to speak about with any level of proficiency, and et cetera. There's such a diversity in the church. you know, and this is one of the things I think people forget, you know, because you hear the buzzword now, diversity, diversity, diversity. And at times I know myself, I get sick of it because, you know, I see how this diversity, as the world speaks about it, turns into nothing but like factionalisms and things like that. You know, but for us Catholics, when we talk about diversity, diversity in essence is kind of a fruit. It's a fruit that rises up from the unity that is offered to Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ is that stone foundation on which we all stand, and we're housed in the church that he has fashioned into his own body. And out of that unity, there's a diversity of the life in Christ. And this is what Paul is speaking about in the First Corinthians chapter 12, you know, the hand is not the foot, et cetera. So we all have our different places and our different roles in the church. But without that foundation of unity, diversity, it just becomes factionalism. And we're already seeing what that poison does in the world and et cetera.
I was kind of brought up in my own adult Catholicism after I reconverted inside a Dominican tradition. And there, I think I'm pronouncing this correctly, the charism is very much intellectual. Is it charism?
Charism, yeah.
Charism. The charism there is very much intellectually focused on spirituality through, I don't want to say intellectual pursuits. It's a strong focus on the doctrine, a strong focus on the sacrament. And those are really the two things I remember the most, is the prominence of the sacrament, the Eucharist, and the intellectual tradition. How would you describe the Carmelite charism?
Well, to sort of go back to that big picture for the mendicants, and I think this will help folks to understand. And I've had a great relationship with a variety of Dominicans when I lived in D.C. and in the Dominican House of Studies, and they've just been wonderful men to me, and I've had great conversations, and I got a lot of respect for many of the Dominicans that I know. But there's sort of four big pillars, four big sort of things that support the mendicant lifestyle. And these thoughts that I'm going to give right now are not from me. I've been told these by other people, and I've wrestled with them and trying to find ways to speak about it in my own way and et cetera. But, you know, these have been spoken about by other people too. You know, I've heard a lot of this from Augustinians and et cetera. But so mendicant spirituality kind of has four big pillars: poverty, community, preaching and studying, and prayer. All the big groups have that. The Franciscans have all four. The Carmelites have all four. The Dominicans have all four. The Augustinians have all four. But which one is the lens for interpreting the others? That's where the difference arises from. And difference doesn't mean a negative thing. It doesn't mean an inequality. It just means different. So for your Franciscans, it's poverty. So they see their lives of prayer through the lens of poverty. They see their community life through the life through the lens of poverty and et cetera. Your Augustinians, all about community. So they see their prayer and their prayer life through the life of community, poverty through community, studying and preaching through community. For the Dominicans, order of preachers, that's their name Dominicans come from the founders, St. Dominic, but officially they're the order of preachers, you know, and they arose up to fight certain heresies that were spreading, I believe, in Spain. And their primary lens is preaching and studying. So they devote a lot of their time to the intellectual pursuit and the intellectual life. So they see their prayer through that lens. They see their, you know, relationship to poverty through that lens. And they see their community life through that lens. So for us Carmelites, our lens is heart, is a heart. From the heart, we pray, of course, but it's prayer, you know. So we look at our lives of poverty, our lives of community, and our lives of studying and preaching all through prayer. So for the Dominican, maybe their central point of prayer may be the chapel, Eucharistic adoration, pondering the things of the Lord and et cetera. For us Carmelites, it's our cell, our room, our little piece of heaven where we can learn to just sit and be present before the Lord and become like Israel, who was able to wrestle with God. You know, it's one of the great distinctions I think that people need to work on making between maybe Christianity and Islam. You know, Islam, it's about submission to the Lord, you know, or they wouldn't say Lord, but, you know, to Allah. Not so for the Christian, enough so for the Jewish people. We wrestle with God. Just read the Psalms. People yell at God. You know, we wrestle with God. You know, God has come to wrestle with us in a profound way, we believe, as Christians, through Jesus Christ, you know, the gift of the incarnation. You know, so for us Carmelites, our spirituality is based upon this life of intimate prayer that we shape in ourselves And then from these moments, we go into our community life and our community prayer. We have, you know, we pray the divine office, you know, which is points of prayer throughout the day based on the Psalms, you know, and we sort of open our hearts to our community and bring forward what's going on with the Lord in our life. And then from there, we go out into the world. So, right now, we have two schools at the parish. I'm at the parish itself. You know, so there's always something going on here. I visit Carmelite sisters that run a nursing home. I offer mass a couple times a week there, and et cetera. And then all those experiences I have in the world, kind of like a bee going around and grabbing all this pollen and et cetera. You know, I come back to the community. We have a meal together. We talk about our day. We watch some news. What are we thinking about things going on in the neighborhood? You know, what should we be doing and et cetera? But then finally, just as the day begins, the day ends in the cell. You know, this place of intimacy where we try, by the grace of God, I can't emphasize that enough, to let our heart become fully open and vulnerable to the Lord. You know, so Carmelites, we really see ourselves as teachers of prayer. And this sort of title as teachers of prayer was given to us sort of in a formal way by Pope Benedict XVI and was reiterated by Pope Francis. You know, Carmelites, those that teach us how to pray.
So I think this podcast is going to be released in between Thanksgiving and the beginning of Advent, which I think this year begins on December the 2nd. Am I correct in thinking?
Yes, that? It's the first Sunday of December. Yeah.
So as somebody who comes from a mostly secular community, it's mm-hmm. really interesting that you were talking there about community and prayer life. One of the hardest things I think for most modern people is the fact that if they are religious, they live inside a secular community. Mm-hmm. And it's very difficult to develop habits of prayer as an individual, or at least I find it very, very difficult to do that. Mm-hmm. And do you think there's a problem in modernity with sort of reconciling the human need for community? Obviously, there's a problem with community generally in the modern world, but it seems to be much worse when it comes also to incorporating spirituality into that community.
A couple things. And one of the things that's coming up in my heart right now, you know, because I think maybe we're also in this postmodern-esque period is, you know, people chase after the feels, you know, they come into wanting to cultivate a life of prayer in order to get some affective, you know, feeling-based experience. Mm-hmm. And in Carmelite spirituality, we use the word affectivity, you know, that's with an A lot, but the way we use it and our saints use it is different than ways it might be understood now in the world. So I talk with, and they're at a variety of different places, maybe on their journey of discipleship and et cetera, you know, but they're chasing after a feeling, you know, like, oh, I had this big experience. I want to go back to it and et cetera. And they, you know, suddenly they're just chasing the next high. So maybe they're not using drugs or et cetera, but, you know, they still have that sort of addictive personality, you know, their appetites for this enjoyment that they receive from some maybe important prayer experience in their life is causing them to go down a very dangerous road. And mm-hmm. then there's the other extreme where this is somewhat maybe Pelagianist, like you just do it by the old bootstraps and pick yourself up and et cetera. You're like Atlas holding up the world. You know, people set such a high standard for themselves in their prayer life. Oh, I've got to do these amount of rosaries, and I got to go, you know, do this in the divine office, and I got to go. It's like a list of to-dos to check off. And they never slow down and open themselves to that question of how does the Lord want me to be with him? Not necessarily yeah. to do for him, you know, and that's a radical question to ask yourself, you know, how does the Lord want me to be with him? One of our great saints, St. John of the Cross, you know, I just wrote an article about his insights on the appetite that's on Catholic Stand, you know, but in his great poem, he was a poet, and then off of his poetry, he wrote reflections and et cetera to break it down for people. You know, he talked about at the end of the dark night of the soul, this movement of the soul where this purification comes about within the heart by the very hands of God. You know, the person that goes through that just is able to rest in like a field of lilies upon the heart of the Lord, the bridegroom, you know, and et cetera. So there's this great mm-hmm. intimacy because Teresa of Avila, she's the saint in our order that I'm a Carmelite because of her. Yeah, she talked about how prayer is just this ability and this way of just being able to sit with the Lord, you know, and here in the, and particularly in the U.S., but certain Asia countries I know about it in Europe too, you know, we always got to be doing and active and et cetera and et cetera, you know, slow down.
Saint Teresa of Avila was the one who wrote The Interior Castle, if I'm not mistaken.
Yes. And exactly. If you want a little bit of a funny history note there, the only reason she wrote it is because The Dominicans, who were running the Inquisition in Spain at that time, confiscated her other writings because she had Jewish ancestry at the time. So her spiritual director says, you know, you're an amazing person in this, in the prayer life. You got to write yourself down. She's like, I already did. It's in my autobiography. But the Dominicans, under obedience to the confessor, she wrote Interior Castle, which is, you know, her sort of penultimate work that she's more, you know, the most sincere, sincere in her thoughts and et cetera, that she's not in her other works. So, you know, I tell my Dominican friends, I said, hey, if you guys didn't, you know, harass her in this way, we wouldn't have had her write this book. So we thank for that. You know, so I tell people, you know, you got to start little. You start little. This is, you know, as Paul tells the Corinthians, you know, he's giving them milk. You got to start little. You know, when people want to, you know, oh, I got to be like this great saint. And the way they understand that saint is a saint on a pedestal, you know, and they themselves never understand maybe in the depths of their heart that they could ever be on that pedestal. You know, you start little and you start asking yourself hard questions. Where can I give a minute for the Lord in silence? Maybe it's in my car right before I enter my office. You're not happy at your work, but I'm going to give this 1-2 minutes. I'm going to just say, Lord, this silence is for you. Cultivate what you want in my heart, so I can be a witness to the people at this place of work. Or if you have children and your children are eating their morning breakfast, take a couple minutes, sit in eyesight of them, and just read the Bible. Not only are you cultivating this prayer and being permeated by the Word of God, but your action is bearing fruit in your child's heart who sees that. My mom, my dad values this book so much that they're able to just sit and just spend time with it every day. That's going to leave a mark in your child, you know, and that's going to plant some seeds and et cetera. You know, so start little, you know, and this is some great insight from St. Francis de Sales. His writing is excellent, especially if you ever want to get into what meekness is and things like that. But he says, pray in a way that suits your lifestyle. You know, if you're a merchant and, you know, a seller of things and et cetera, you can't pray like a monk because you're not a monk. You know, you have to find ways that suit your life and et cetera. So finding a devotion that speaks to you. If I love icons, I could just sit before an icon and just stare at that icon for 15, 20 minutes and just, you know, my heart's just moved. You know, maybe it's a beautiful music that just puts your heart, you know, maybe some classical thing that just puts your heart at peace. You know, some concrete things though is you got to be spending some time with the Bible, you know, so throughout the week, just, you know, et cetera, going with one of the great gifts we have in the Catholic Church is the lectionary, where, you know, if you go to a Sunday mass, you know, every Sunday for 3 years, you know, you're going to pretty much get, you know, the whole Bible, you know, about 92-93%, you know. But one of the things that we Carmelites try to do, and this is a very important bit of scripture for us, is when Elijah feels downtrodden, you know, he's thought he's won the people back to the Lord, you know, he slayed the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel, and then suddenly Jezebel works him up and cuts him to the heart, and he sees the people aren't maybe fully with him, and he goes off into the desert to, in a way, I'll say it, you know, commit suicide. He went under a boom tree to die, and the Lord comes to him and through an angel and says, Elijah, you know, drink this water. He drinks it, then Elijah rests again, eat this cake, boom. You know, you'll need these things. Get up and eat, or the journey will be too strong. So he makes this journey, Elijah does, through the desert, 40 days, something that shouldn't be lost on us, symbolically thinking, of course. You know, Christ, 40 days in the desert, you know, the movement of the Jewish people, 40 years. And then he goes to Mount Horeb. And this is one of the actions that we see in Elijah's life that the Lord didn't tell him specifically to go. The Lord didn't say, go to Horeb in the passage. Go to Sinai, no. And it's also very important that Elijah went to Horeb and not Sinai. In the Bible, they're sort of seen as the same mountain or maybe within the same mountain range. But Horeb invokes the fiery bush. Mm. You know, this thing that is consumed by the flames of God's love, but never destroyed. Sinai is the covenant, the tent. So we are told that Elijah goes to Mount Horeb, invoking that sense of the fiery bush. And then he's distraught. The earthquake happens. God's not in the earthquake. The mighty wind happens. God's not in the mighty wind. A great fire comes down upon the mount. God's not in that. And then suddenly, In a still small breeze, Elijah can hear the Lord, and he covers himself. You know, and the Lord says, why are you here? You know, he says, I'm zealous for you, my Lord. You know, and this movement, you know, which this humanity of Elijah that's being brought before us in this profound way, you know, that's sort of the movement within our prayer life. We have to get to this place where we can really look at ourselves in a hard way that's not comfortable, that doesn't make us always feel good. You know, feelings are important, but they can be very mischievous and devious. You know, one of the things John of the Cross warns us is, you know, our moments of consolation with the Lord, where he comes and we feel his peaceful presence and et cetera. What happens is we can begin to think of that experience alone as a God, and we make it into our idol instead of worshiping the one true God. So there's this call to go deeper into the recesses of the heart and go to those barren places that, you know, maybe our fear would keep us back from. You know, Carmelite spirituality is really a spirituality about engaging and fighting against idolatry in order to live in allegiance to the one true Lord.
This is something that I think we have a very difficult time expressing in the modern world. Mm-hmm. I'm not so sure what the solution is, but it seems to be hard to find moments like this in modern life. Mm-hmm. I don't know if it's obviously, it probably is a flaw of modernity. But not only can, you know, is it hard to sort of work into a schedule and hard to get your mind into that state, it's also hard to communicate what you're really doing to other people who might not understand spirituality or prayer or these things.
And they, you know, maybe they don't need to understand at that moment, but they can see that it has done something, and they have an experience from encountering the person that's trying to cultivate a life of prayer. And they see the goodness that arises from that life, even though they may not understand the truthfulness of these points of prayer and et cetera, but they see a beauty, they see a goodness, they sense these things they may not have. One of the things I deal with when I was working at a college university with another brother is there's an absence of a language that, you know, our younger generations have not been given a language in which to speak about these experiences with the Lord.
Yeah. We don't have a language to discuss it.
And I think that's why beauty is so important. Beautiful poets, artists. I really believe this, and I've said this on other podcasts and other videos I've done with people. I really believe in a certain way, the Catholic Church is in a beautiful renaissance, and we're not acknowledging it, because through my work in social media ministry that I'm doing on behalf of the order, I've met so many Catholic YouTubers and Catholic podcasters and Catholic bloggers and Catholic writers and Catholic artists, you know, that are just on fire for the Lord and hungry for the Lord. And they're just putting themselves out there in such intimate, in vulnerable ways that, you know, they're just planting so many seeds around the world. It's really quite amazing. This is that sort of leaven that impacts the world that helps it to rise up in a very beautiful way. So, you know, just people being able to hear conversations like this and view in, and I hope I love my vocation, and it's a point of joy for me. It's not always easy. Just as marriage life isn't always easy, yes. Single life, you know, these things aren't easy, but just because something's not easy doesn't mean it's not good.
And yeah, we often forget that.
Yeah, you know, the path of least resistance people like to go down, you know, and you know, there's no life on that path. You know, if you want to have a good garden, you got to work the dirt. You work the dirt so the dirt can receive the seed and receive the water, so the nourishment and the goodness from it can permeate those seeds and something you can have a bountiful garden that hopefully goes beyond its borders to take care of so many people. I know I just read a book recently. I'm looking at it on my shelf there. It's Leah Libresco. She is writing sort of a guide to the Benedict option that came out from Rod Dreher. I saw her speak in person at First Things here in New York City. Amazing speaker. If she's coming to your area to speak, highly recommend.
But we had her on the podcast about a month and a half ago.
Oh, wonderful. Just a great spirit. Her husband's a wonderful guy. I think her husband works for Benedict. But her book is a very easy read, like you're not getting caught up in a lot of jargon. But she writes with so many different perspectives to offer different ways to sort of create this community life. You know, and I think this is one of the things that we got to look at too.
It's interesting that you bring up Leah Libresco and building the Benedict option and perhaps the Benedict option itself. And this is not supposed to be a controversial podcast, at least not this episode. But I do bring this up to a lot of Catholic guests. people are talking more and more about this Benedict option, this radical change that we need in interacting with modern culture. Mm-hmm. Rod Dreher is a little cagey about the details.
Yeah.
Leah Labresco much less so. I'm very grateful for that, in fact. But at the same time, I every time I come across a Catholic author who largely speaks to practicing faith in modernity, I want to ask them their opinion on the Benedict option. Is this something we need to be looking into? And if we are looking into it, what does it mean? What does it mean for people who are living this radically different path than the one that's chosen by modernity?
From my experience, you know, there's what Rod Dreher wrote and there's what people think that he wrote. You know, mm-hmm. there's this discrepancy there, you know, because some people might be, this is just my opinion and my gut sense, people sort of sense like escapism, you know? And first off, I find that somewhat disrespectful because what about the Desert Fathers that out of them, and Desert Mothers too, out of them rose, you know, the monasteries. And what was the point of monasteries? Just to call it escapism doesn't do the history any service.
There's two possibilities. One is that it could be escapism, but I don't think it ever is. I mean, it could be separatism or it could be rebellion. If it's a radical rejection of modernity, it's not that I don't take it seriously. Yeah. A radical rejection of modernity is very, very serious, but it's also, it's a path that has a lot of consequences. I don't know if we understand exactly what those consequences are going to be.
Yeah, well, no one ever does. That's why historians have to help us to see the working of maybe God's providence in history, and et cetera. Two things I think that fit well here. One from the scriptures is the great passage from, I think it's 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. I forget the verse off the top of my head, where Paul tells them, test all things and keep what is good. So when we look at modernity, test all things, keep what is good. That's one of the reasons I think people get so upset with us Catholics is, you know, maybe they sense this cherry picking stuff, but this is what prudence is for. This is one of the great virtues that we're called to cultivate, you know, so test all things and keep what is good. And the other thing comes from the Carmelite rule, the very end of the Carmelite rule. The writer of our rule is St. Albert of Jerusalem. And he's writing a letter to us, and that letter became our rule. You know, and he said, I wrote you many good and great things. I'm paraphrasing here, of course. I wrote you many good and great things. You know, and to do beyond these things I wrote is awesome and nice, but he uses but a lot in the rule, but never exceed the bounds of common sense.
Perhaps this is what Dominicans mean when they say saving distinctions.
Yeah, the common sense is because that'll keep you from falling into pride. Because just look at the Desert Fathers, for Pete's sake. They went out there and they were communities reforming left and right. Because there was something beautiful going on there. There was something good going on there. There was something honest and truthful going on there, you know, and people sensed the goodness of the Lord and they were attracted to that. So, for example, one of the things I think that we can begin to cultivate is a sense of household, not just a sense of family. We spend a lot of time in the church talking about family, and families are the utmost importance. And there's just a great article on this topic in November's First Things. You know, I have a family. You know, my biological family, I'm not talking about my Carmelite family right now, but I have a biological family. Most of them are in Michigan, where I'm from. I'm no longer part of that household. I'm here in New York. I'm in this community here. Mm-hmm. And there's important distinctions between those two. And is, you know, we need to cultivate a sense of a household, which is this sort of common living together in our experiences of the Lord. You know, so if you're, maybe a couple college kids, you know, there's a way of cultivating this sense of household. There's a reason that our churches developed out of household churches and et cetera, you know, instead of just seeing people as hardline family, blood relationships, which are important, you know, but where our families now, and particularly in the United States, you know, some of my parishioners here, they got kids at the four points of the U.S., you know, Washington State, California, Florida, et cetera, you know, and their house feels cold. And they know it, and they tell me about it, and they speak about it. And we don't know what to do. I'm like, well, you have a family, but you don't have a household because there's an emptiness here. So, you know, and then from that, we talk about opening them up to have a little place of prayer, having some other parishioners over, leading a rosary once a week, having a Bible study there in their house. So, you know, they come to the parish church for their, you know, sacramental needs and their communal needs and et cetera, you know, but they also have this little extension off of the parish where they're also continuing to cultivate themselves in the life of the Spirit. You know, so the Benedict option, I think, is One of the things I think it's doing that we really need to embrace is we need to have a cold, hard look at what's going on in the world. And we got to stop being afraid to call spades a spade. You know, like we do not save the world. We are called to save souls. We do not create heaven here on earth. One of the things, and this is my little rant, and I may get in trouble for this or not. I think there's a twisting of this sort of kingdom building, you know, building the kingdom of God in earth mixed with notions of utopianism. And somehow that missionary spirit became like an NGO spirit. We don't save the world. Christ saves the world. We aid our brothers and sisters in the world. Now that doesn't mean we pollute the environment and all that sort of stuff. But if your eyes aren't focused on the right thing, if your heart's not resting on the right thing, you know, all the other things are going to be out of order. It's going to be a terrible disharmony. You know, I think we have to realize that, you know, we're out there to save souls and to bear witness to Jesus Christ and to aid people in their pain and their suffering, not just in a physical way, but a spiritual way, both and, not either or.
But what happens, and this is a question I get a lot talking to a lot of young men, especially in the last 5 years online. What happens when you look out into the world and see only spades?
All right.
I think this is a danger. A lot of people are looking, they're seeing the darkness. They're just not seeing the solution. And, you know, I think there is a spiritual solution, but you know, I think they're also, people are also looking for a temporal one as well.
I try to read one book a month. I just finished two great ones and I'll put them out there. One is from Dr. Warren Farrell, A Boy Crisis. Highly recommend. He and I forget the other writer are looking at what's going on with boys and masculinity sort of in the Western world, although they do look at different Eastern countries and et cetera. One of the big things he talks about is purpose void. There's an absence of purpose in young men's hearts, you know, and that darkness isn't neutral. It has an impact on the soul. And the other thing is there's been a movement from sort of heroic intelligence to emotional intelligence. You know, we're not cultivating an atmosphere in which we're preparing our boys maybe for going off to war all the time. And there's ramifications culturally speaking and societally speaking from that. But then also these things sort of impact the absence of fathers and et cetera. The other book I read was A Manual for Men, who came out of the Diocese of Phoenix by Bishop Olmsted. Really great looks at that. And one of the things that he recommended within that text is, you know, really looking hard at your male friendships. What's going on? Why are you friends with these men? Are they just drinking buddies? We use that word friend way too liberally, way too easily. You know, C.S. Lewis has a great book called The Four Loves and et cetera. You know, and from my own experience, to have two or three really true, great friends where you can share a horizon together and that you don't need to fill up your space with a lot of words and BS, you know, those are true friends. So, you know, really reflect on and have some intention in your relationship with your masculine, you know, I'm talking to men right now, obviously, with your other masculine friends, and cultivate spaces and be not afraid to, you know, go to these areas, you know, like, man, I'm spiritually not feeling all right now. This is what's going on. Or, you know, I'm having a little porn issue here. And, you know, don't be ashamed of these things and let them stay in the dark. You know, one of the things is, you know, allowing them to come into the light.
A lot of people just don't have any friends is what I'm finding.
Yeah. Online technology is a truly insidious. It's a great thing, but it can also be insidious. It's two-edged sword at the same time. And this is, how do I want to put this? I mean, this is a way why teasing is so important. We're all over and against bullying, and I'm right with that. You know, like you should never, you know, no person has a right to physically assault another person for any reason whatsoever, whether it's their sexual orientation, color of their skin, religion, whatever. You know, you don't get to assault people. But yet we've gone to such an extreme, like we humans tend to do, that we forget that there was something important about joking with people, of being other men joking with other men, you know, where we feel each other out. And this is, you know, when the households are falling apart and et cetera, we lose these social skills. And one of the reasons I'm able to take a joke is because my brother and I were just able to cut into each other so much. And at times it got dark, yeah. But at other times, as I reflect now, like, oh, that really loosened me up in this area. And that helped me to relate to other men in these areas and et cetera. That, you know, men, you know, have to have these external manifestations in relationship to this sort of movement into adulthood, where in relationship to women, they have these things too, but something radically shifts in a woman's body that offers kind of a fundamental point of distinction. For men, it's always been somewhat externalized, you know? So for me, you know, I'm from a hunting culture. My dad was a hunter, a trapper, and et cetera. We needed the meat during the summer so we could use our money in other places and et cetera. He taught me respect for the land. But I knew when I was at 14 and I was able to go with the other men and my dad to deer camp up in the UP of Michigan, the Upper Peninsula. And I was able to now sit at the table with these other men and participate in the conversation and say jokes. Oh, it was awkward. At times, you know, I'd make a joke that would bomb and they were cutting me for certain things and things like that.
Yeah. But
when we left after that week of being away from women, just with other men and cultivating this bond, I knew that there was something different inside of me. I didn't know how to express it at the time. And I knew there was a change in my father and I's relationship, you know, and I could sense that, you know, I was becoming a little bit more of an adult, you know, and et cetera. So, you know, we have to be able to go out there as men and work with that. And, you know, some of the guys here at the parish, you know, oh, we don't have a lot of money to do these things. I said, money's our last concern. Do you have time? Do you have talents? Yeah. I was like, think about our parishes. Imagine some of the wisdom figures. I don't like to call elderly people like old or et cetera. Wisdom figures. They have a wisdom from their years of experience and et cetera. That, now, when I say that, I'm not saying that young people aren't wise. That's not true. But just in relationship to this segment of our population, I show respect by using the term wisdom figure. And I say, imagine if these guys with this carpentry wisdom, with, you know, maybe teaching wisdom, all these sort of things, if they just open themselves up to little classes to work with other young men, you know, late high school, early 20s, you know, let's just do some woodwork and let's fix some things up around the church, you know, teaching them how to use certain things that, you know, maybe they've never been taught or shown because their dad wasn't really at home, you know, was in jail or abandoned the family or was working all the time or et cetera, you know. Those little moments of intimacy for men are of the utmost importance. And from the outside, people may not see it as intimate because, you know, oh, they're not talking about their feelings, but there is an aspect of intimacy that's happening there, you know, that can rise up naturally in an organic way from our masculine selves.
It hits on two things. It hits first on sort of our crisis of masculinity and masculine interaction. And then it hits on the fact that we just don't have a way of properly honoring those who are more aged, those of the previous generation. There seems to be really an inversion where in the past, both those things were respected and now they're more or less denigrated.
Well, yeah, we worship the young, you know, and the youth and people, look at what people go through for plastic surgery to deform their bodies just to look like they once were, even though they could never go back. I work with the Carmelite Sisters of the Aged and Infirm. They were a group that were started here in the United States, and in my province helped to guide them in the ways of Carmel as their Venerable Mother Angeline McCroy really cultivated ways of taking care of wisdom figures, you know, our senior citizens and et cetera. You know, and when I go visit them, I just see, oh, people, my obligation is met. I got mom and dad into a good nursing home. They'll take care of it, and they rarely visit. And this is something we in the States can learn from our brothers and sisters in Africa, our brothers and sisters in Central and South America, who have maintained these strong filial ties and reverence for the older generations and et cetera, that we have sort of put aside because, you know, of our function, I don't want to put this, you know, functionalistic mindset, you know, like, oh, they can't function as good as they once were, you know, so I can still be a good son, a good daughter, and put them in a good nursing home now. I'm not insulting people. I hope I'm not insulting people by that. You know, if someone's suffering from Alzheimer's and needs special care, yes. But just paying for these things is not enough. Time, talent, and treasure. You got time. You know, to honor thy father or thy mother just doesn't mean to give them nice things. They need your presence in their life also at that time in their life. So I just, you know, when I mention these to the men in the parish, and I just see them at little moments and little events, when we have big fiestas in the gymnasium and suddenly I see some of the older men pulling the young kids, which they never did before, like teenagers, from the tables and say, help us serve the people here. Help walk with us. And to see these young boys' face, suddenly they're being pulled out of these tables by these men that are respected at the parish, and they're working side by side, just carrying plates of food to people. It's amazing. Mm. It's not too complex. It's not too, you know, you got to write a manual and this, that, you know, it's simple, you know, local, small, and it grows out from there. That's why I liked Leah's book so much, because, you know, there's these great practical things, you know, in different way of handling things that, because sometimes we can overthink things, you know, we can overthink things and we've got to make this big grandioso sort of movement, when really the monks arose just from a couple of guys and gals going out into the desert wanting to cultivate a relationship with the Lord. The Carmelite order started with just a couple of people wanting to go to the Holy Land, and they chose to settle on Mount Carmel. You know, it starts with little things, littleness. And then out of that littleness, like a mustard seed, as the scriptures remind us, you know, the big bush grows. You know, sometimes I think we try to start with just ripping a big bush out of something and trying to put that big bush down in the dirt there, and it dies on us because we didn't take care of the roots enough or whatever.
I want to end on one final question, mm-hmm. since we're coming up on time. Mm-hmm. Obviously, I mentioned at the beginning that we're entering into Advent, or at least we will be when this podcast airs. And I think, well, for my secular viewers, everyone is aware of Advent, or the season leading up to Christmas, as the time of consumption, of pre-gaming Christmas, as I call it. Mm-hmm. Oftentimes people are surprised to see that Advent is a penitential season in most regards. Yeah. Mm-hmm. How would you recommend that people who are both Catholic and Christian, or seeking spirituality from a deist or agnostic point of view, approach this Advent season in light of the tradition of those spiritual masters who went before us?
One thing. There's many things, but one that's coming to my heart right now. Ask yourself where the tradition of the Christmas tree came from. Mm. Look up St. Boniface and see what St. Boniface did, this monk from England with the German people. And spend time just wrestling with the symbols of Advent, you know, that way when you're just wanting to understand what's going on with all these sort of things, your heart, your mind slow down because you're beginning to focus on these things that you sort of maybe taken for granted, you know, because we remember the first coming of Christ during Advent in order to prepare for the second coming of Christ. And there's a reason that traditions like the Christmas tree and the Advent wreath have come about. And the story of St. Boniface is an amazing one. He's one of my big top fives saints. And so I just invite people to spend some time looking into that saint and what his actions did to help to shape the Advent season.
That's some really great advice, Father. Mm-hmm. So with that, I will say thank you very much, Father Nick, for mm-hmm. giving us this time for the interview, some very good spiritual insights. I hope you have a great rest of the evening.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. If anybody wants to email me about anything I said in this video, they can go to my website, thefrankfriar.com. There's a contact page. They can email me through that, or Carmelite Nick on Twitter. These are great places if anyone wants to maybe share something or get a little guidance, and etc.
Excellent. And I highly recommend your YouTube channel to the people who are listening. Mm-hmm. At any rate, thank you very much for this interview, and yeah. I hope you have a great evening.
You too. Thank you very much for the opportunity. Keep doing the great work that you're doing through this great bit of service that you're offering the people out there in the world.
Listening to Father Nick, I'm not so sure that I have anything to add, certainly not on the spiritual dimension, or even concerning suggestions about how we could or should pursue virtue in the real world. But just as a final cutoff, before I say goodbye to our audience and wish them a happy Advent, I perhaps could talk a little bit about what I hope VIA OBSCURA, the website and the podcast, might serve. Now, as many people have pointed out, of all of the things I create online, from videos to blog posts, the VIA OBSCURA radio episodes and even the website and blog for that matter, are somewhat less popular. They're less contentious, they're less focused. They tend to involve conversations with people who already have very established opinions, who are covered in the mainstream more than the typical YouTube crowd. Yet I nonetheless think that this podcast and the website VIA OBSCURA is important. I think it can be a resource for people, a starting point, a front page for reactionary, conservative, and traditionalist ideas, and a staging area for interacting with the mainstream. Conversation is important, and cultivating people who can have those conversations is important as well. As people might understand listening to this, VIA OBSCURA is a resource for all listeners. We welcome submissions, both op-ed and on occasion fiction, as long as it's targeted at our larger mission of critiquing modernity, that is. And I'd like to think that I work with people who contribute to this blog and podcast to become better communicators of the ideas that we discuss right here, to become, in some sense, ambassadors for ideas that are frankly far outside the mainstream. Now, of course, this isn't a job for me. This is a passion project. Nevertheless, popular enough, this is the reason why VIA OBSCURA will continue, come what may, in other dimensions of my life. I want it to be a resource for the people who are truly interested. And for what it's worth, as this year draws to a close, I hope it's been helpful to you, our listeners, because this project is for you, and I want to know what I can do to help. Now, of course, in this coming Christmas season, I think listeners can look forward to more guests. We'll try to include at least one podcast of a more Christmassy theme. But going forward, VIA OBSCURA will persist into 2019, and I think we have many opportunities ahead of us. Good evening, and have a blessed Advent season.